Good evening, everybody. We're glad you're here tonight, Calvary Chapel La Mesa, for our Good Friday evening service. The title of this service is The Power of the Cross. Amen. The Power of the Cross. And you look at this cross over here, that might have been the size of the cross that was on top of that hill called Golgotha. And you don't want to carry that thing. Dan's carried that thing so much, you can see the blood stains up there.
Ouch.
That thing is heavy, but usually it would just be carrying one plank that they would take. They would carry their own cross up to Golgotha, and then their hands and their feet would be nailed to it. So we're here to remember what Jesus did for us on the cross 2,000 years ago when he paid the price for our sins. And we have much to give thanks for. Our sins have been forgiven and washed away. There's power in the blood. Power in the name of Jesus. Amen? So let's pray, and I'm going to ask Sharon if she would open us up in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we are just so in awe of your glory and your goodness and your mercy in our lives. And we thank you for sending your Son and for his obedience to the cross. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit will just move tonight among us and touch our hearts in a way that we know that we've been with you.
Yes.
We pray that you would bring us into a state of worship and ready to receive your word tonight. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
In Jesus' name. Let's worship the Lord. If you want to stand, you can stand. If you want to sit, you can sit. And let's join in praise to God tonight.
Go ahead and stand if you can.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Proved he loved you. by staying on the cross. He could have called it quits at any minute. He proved he loved you by staying on the cross.
Oh,
know it's pretty hard to stand next to the cross of Jesus with him hanging there bleeding for us and have any pride at all in how good we are, because we see what drove him to the cross, our sin. I think it's a good thing on this Good Friday to think about the price of the cross and what drove him there for us.
Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. And oh, the blood of Jesus.
Holy, holy.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
That song, Lord God Almighty reigns.
Praise his name. Blessed
and we have victory through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and what he did on the cross 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We're glad all those watching online are joining us tonight as we celebrate what God did for us. He said, do this in remembrance of him. We remember Jesus. Help us never to forget. Keep our focus on Jesus.
That's exactly right. Amen.
There's so many verses that talk about that, and we'll take a look at them tonight. But the ushers will come forward, and if you have a Good Friday offering, just put it in the bag as it comes around. And musicians will take their spots. And I want you to open up your Bibles to the book of Matthew. You can go ahead and pass around. Matthew chapter 16. And hopefully you all have outlines that you can take a look at tonight. Okay? And you can see Matthew chapter 16, verse 21. It says, from that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem. He was going to go to Jerusalem. And it says, and suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, the scribes. And he tells us, even before it happened, and be killed. He was going to be killed. And then it says, and he was going to be raised on the third day.
Hallelujah.
And good old Peter, man, he had foot and mouth disease. Continually put his foot in his mouth. And he starts to rebuke Jesus. Can you imagine Peter rebuking Jesus? And he says, God forbid it. Verse 22, Lord, this shall never happen to you.
Uh-oh.
It's not going to happen. And Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. And this is what a lot of people are doing today, where it says, part of that verse, he says, you are not setting your mind on God's interest. Man, isn't that true of people today? Not setting their mind on God's interest, just like Peter, but man's. Amen. And then Jesus said to his disciples, if anybody wishes to come after me, let him deny himself and take up what? His cross and follow me. God wants us to take up our crosses. It's not a literal cross, but, you know, the sacrifices of obedience that we make. Take up your cross daily and follow me. And it says in verse 25, for whoever wishes to save his life shall lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake shall find it. For what shall a man be profited if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? You know, a lot of people exchange their souls for a lot of different things in our society today. You know, they're forfeiting their life. They're forfeiting eternal life. You know, it's so sweet today. I was telling you on last weekend that we were doing the Good Friday service at Lantern Crest Retirement Home. And as we were doing the sermon and just talking about what Jesus did for us on the cross, I looked at the people that were there, and a couple of them have had streams of tears coming down from their faces. You know, and it was so sweet, you know, and as we were singing the songs, they were just belting them out, you know. They knew those songs for so many years ago from being in church. And afterwards, they were saying how grateful they were that we would come and do a service on Good Friday. And they were asking about, are we going to be back on Easter Sunday? And I said, well, we're going to do a church service on Saturday night, Easter service at 6:30. We'll do an Easter service on Sunday morning at 10 at the church. And then, you know, we'll come back and there'll be some people here to do a service for you guys at 2 o'clock. So there's going to be a service again there. And, you know, what's exciting is that you never know when you give out the gospel, you never know what's going to happen. You know, God says that his word will not return void. It's not going to return void. And, you know, I mean, who knows if someone accepts the Lord, you know, just from a little church service. You know, it's a beautiful facility. I've never seen such a beautiful facility. But one thing they added to this facility was a chapel. Someone had the foresight to add a chapel, you know, in the midst of this big retirement home and three stages of retirement that they had there. And the chapel that they added was beautiful. It must have cost them a lot of money to do that. But they knew down the line that there would be a chapel service that would take place there. And fortunately, you know, in God's timing, we were able to give on Christmas the first chapel service in that building. And, you know, hopefully it'll be used for God's honor and glory in the future. The cross, the symbol of the cross. You know, I was thinking about how it's found in a lot of different places. It's found on clerical robes that some people wear. It's found on the top of mountains. There's a mountain in Poway, a big cross on it. You know, somebody owns it, put a cross up there, lights it up at night. Amen. Mount Helix, big cross up at Mount Helix. And then Mount Soledad has a big cross on it. But there's been a lot of lawsuits that people have brought, and they said, we want to take down the crosses. They didn't want that symbol of what Jesus did 2,000 years ago to be up there. So it's offensive to them. They tried to, you know, get the government to take it down, and fortunately they couldn't do it. There's crosses on grave sites. They wanted to get rid of the crosses on the grave sites. You know, there's crosses. I mean, if you go to foreign countries, they've taken down crosses all across, you know, different places, in Europe and other places, because they didn't want to be remembered or reminded about what Jesus did on the cross. Some people wear it around their neck. Some people wear it as decorations, you know, pretty thing to wear. They say it's a sign of the Crusaders. You know, let's get rid of it. Interesting enough, and I was doing some background on this, and that is that Emperor Nero, and he lived in the first century AD, right around Jesus' time. He so hated Christians that he had a symbol, and it was the upside down cross. And that was a symbol of his hatred for Christians. And it was a symbol of division, a symbol of hate. And yet, I just saw a TV program today where there was a kid that was coloring a, quote, peace symbol. It wasn't a peace symbol. It was a symbol that Emperor Nero came up with for his hatred for Christians. And so as Christians, the cross for us is always the symbol of how Jesus rescued us from our sins. He rescued us from our sins. Every person here, raise your hand. Come on, Joel. We are all sinners. Dan's got two hands up back there. We're all sinners. Okay, saved by grace. And so the cross to us is the symbol that Jesus bought us with the price of his blood. He bought us. Every person here, the power of the cross. You know, I look forward to Good Friday services because we need to be reminded of what Jesus did for us on the cross. I mean, you look at this little crown here. Not a little crown. Look at the size of those thorns. This is called a crown of thorns. It was similar. It was from Jerusalem, actually. And you can see the size of those things. And you can imagine that crown of thorns being pushed down. Steve, you want to be an example of that? No. That pushing down on Jesus' head. After being beaten up 39 times, lashes, 39. And then being punched and, you know, all kinds of things being made a mockery of. And so, you know, I mean, we need to keep the cross, what Jesus did, on our minds and our hearts and remember that. The Bible frequently makes it clear that the cross of Jesus is the heart of the Bible message. It's the heart of the Bible message. And, you know, look on the bottom of your outline here, and it says, there's over 1,300 references, over 1,300 references in the New Testament to the cross and atonement for our sins. Over 1,300. That's amazing. If you think about that in the New Testament, and not only that, but then you contrast that, there's over 290 times in the New Testament where the love of God is spoken of. 290, the love of God. 1,300 references to the cross and the atonement of sins. I think it might have been pretty important for all of us. Assurance of salvation and forgiveness can be received through what Jesus did for us on the cross. He shed his blood for us. Now, here's some scripture verses. I want you just, you can look them up. I don't know if they had time to put it on the screen. 1 Corinthians 2:2. Paul said, I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Man, that's pretty powerful, isn't it? That was the message that Paul preached everywhere he went, Jesus Christ and him crucified. And then in 1 Corinthians 1:17, he says, I didn't come to you in cleverness of speech or wisdom of words. He says, I didn't come to you that way. You know, I want Jesus Christ and the cross to be seen. You know, to he said it all throughout the gospel, all throughout the scriptures. Here's Paul constantly pointing to people to the cross. That's why they want to get rid of the cross. They don't want to have anything to do with the cross. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. Here's Paul again, and he says, "For the word of the cross is to those who are perishing foolishness." It's foolishness to the non-Christian because they have blinders on. Satan's blinded them. It's foolishness to those that are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. I love that. It's the power of God. That's why I said the power of the cross. The power of God. One other verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23. Here Paul says again, "We preach Christ crucified." And then he says, "To Jews, it's a stumbling block. And to Gentiles, it seems like foolishness." Wow. You know, people today are seeking all kinds of different things. Fame, power, money, prestige. You know, they're seeking all these different things. You know, hey, I don't want any problems. I want the government to take care of my problems. No trials, you know, no trials. And it's like when we used to take the kids to, when we had the school here, we used to go to Sacramento. And in Sacramento, we'd go to this river where they used to, it used to be like gold mine river. You know, they would all, everybody would be panning for gold. I don't know if you've seen the TV program. I forget the name of it, but, what is it? Yukon Gold. Yeah, Alaska Gold, San Diego Gold. I don't know. But, if you watch this thing, sometimes they get nothing, and sometimes they go and they hit gold. And one guy and his crew found enough gold. It was something like $2 million in one day. That's amazing, $2 million. But so often it just vanishes. It's like fool's gold. It isn't worth anything. You know, when the kids were out there, we'd take those pans to show them how they did it, and they had a place that was set up where they could go and they could, you know, sift off all the bad stuff and see if there was any gold left. And, you know, as they were panning, they had planted fool's gold. And so the kids would light up, "Oh, look at this, I got gold. There's gold." I didn't have the heart to tell them it's fool's gold, but, you know, Jesus said, "Let's make it clear so that everybody could hear it. I'm going to Jerusalem. There's a place there called Calvary, and they will kill me. They will crucify me. And then after 3 days, what did he say? I will rise again from the grave. I will rise again from the grave." And even the closest disciples of Jesus left. They deserted him. There was a few women that were left. And then the Roman guard saw everything that was going on and all the things were happening. Even the Roman guard, who was to worship Caesar, he looks at everything that happened on the cross and he says, "Truly, this is the Son of God." Even he recognized it. And then years later, when Paul was in prison in Rome and preaching to the guards, it says, even members of Caesar's own household accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Is there anything impossible with God? Nothing impossible with God. Turn to Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. We're going to be preaching about Jesus this Saturday night and Sunday. Hopefully you can come and bring back some friends with you. And Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. But may it never be that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Man, he just says, I want to boast about the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, about what Jesus did for us on that cross 2,000 years ago. You know, everything else he says is like garbage, except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now, it also says that a scripture verse that says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives where? In me. Christ who lives in me. You know, and so we're not to be conformed to this world, but we're to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Now, they hated Jesus. And Jesus said, if they hate me, they're going to hate you because of what you stand for. And it says you will be persecuted for righteousness' sake. And you talk about Jesus and you talk about Good Friday and you talk about Easter Sunday. You know, today that's not very popular. It's not a popular topic, is it? You know, I mean, it's like hate culture today, that people don't like to hear about Jesus. You know, and don't want to know that you're a Christian and you stand for Jesus. And, you know, I'm glad you guys are all here today, and I'm glad so many are watching online, because, I mean, I hope as long as we can open up these doors that we will always preach Jesus Christ. We're always going to preach Jesus and His great love for us. That while we were yet sinners, He died for us on the cross. While we were yet sinners. And He's given us eternal life in His name. You know, you look at all those references, 1,300 references. And the reason that he points to the cross in the New Testament is because it represents forgiveness. Tell the person next to you, you've been forgiven. We've been forgiven. And how many times did he say to forgive one another? What is it, seven times 70, 490. No, he just says we just keep forgiving and forgiving and forgiving, just like Christ has forgiven us. We just keep forgiving. In Romans chapter 6, verse 11, you know, I know, you know, people come to church and they've had hard days sometimes, and you know, disappointments, discouragement, you know, depressed, you know, feeling like there's no hope, and, you know, when's this world going to change, and so many other things. But there is always hope with Jesus. In Romans chapter 6, verse 11, even so, consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Consider yourselves dead to sin, and alive to God. You know, He's given us that resurrection life. And the greatest event of all time and eternity was when Jesus took all of our sins upon Himself. It's just like we're taking our sins, write them all out, and just nail them to the cross. And then Jesus says, don't take them back again. You know, well, I got to take this one back and this one back. No, nail it to the cross. Dead to sin, alive to Jesus. Alive to Christ. And the last scripture verse is Hebrews chapter 2. Turn to Hebrews chapter 2. Verse 14. For since then the children share in flesh and blood, he himself, Jesus, always partook the same, that through death he might render powerless. Hallelujah. Remember that. Through his death, he rendered powerless Satan, okay, who had the power of death, that is the devil, and there is a literal devil, created angel, and that he might deliver those who through the fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. I know a lot of people that are enslaved to fear. Enslaved, I met some today. Enslaved to fear. Afraid of death. Afraid of death. Okay, they're afraid of death. He's all right. He's okay. He's blind and there's certain things going on. So it's okay. Sam, it's all right. Afraid to death. They're afraid of death. Okay? And God says he's not a God of fear, but of might, power, and what? Sound mind. Might, power, and a sound mind. You know, one of my favorite stories is a story of a father and a son who worked for months to build a toy sailboat. And they would go every day, every night when the guy got home from work, they would go into the garage and they'd work on this toy sailboat for hours. It was a labor of love. Love for each other, the father and the son, and then love for the thing that they were creating. And then when the boat was finished, they took, kind of looked at it, and they admired it, and they painted it. It was so beautiful. And after they painted it, they put up the white sails, and then they wanted to take it to the lake. So similar to, it was actually bigger than Lake Murray, but a big lake. And they tied a little string on the end of the sail so that when it sailed off, they could always bring it back, right? Well, as the sailboat started just beautifully going across the water, someone in a motorboat came across the string, cut the string, and the boat just kept going off and off and off. I mean, it performed so beautifully, and they couldn't find it. They spent hours trying to find this sailboat that they created, and they wept. They cried over this sailboat because they spent so much time together and put so much effort into finding this thing. Well, a few weeks later, the boy was walking home from school. He passed his favorite toy store and he saw a toy sailboat in the window. It was his sailboat. He ran inside to claim the boat, telling the owner about his experience on the lake. The store owner explained, well, he had found the boat while on a fishing trip, and he said this. It's kind of sad. You may be its maker, but as a finder, I am its legal owner. You can buy it back for $100. The boy was stunned, his mouth just wide open, and a rat is right. And this is how the story went. $100 to a young kid. But it was so precious to him that he quickly set about earning the money to buy it back, mowing lawns, cleaning windows. Months later, he walked into the toy store and handed the owner $100 in exchange for his sailboat. It was the happiest day of that young boy's life. As he left the store, he held up the boat, the little sailboat, to the sunlight, and its colors gleamed as though it was newly painted. And this is what he said. This is so important for Good Friday. The boy said, I made you, but I lost you. Now I bought you back. That makes you twice mine, and it's mine forever. Now, what did Jesus say? I made you, And I bought you with the price of my blood on the cross. And so now I created you. I bought you back. You're twice mine. You're twice mine. And Jesus said, you're going to be with me forever in heaven. I created you. I lost you. But I bought you from the slave market with my blood. So we're going to pass out the communion cups and, you know, just take one as it goes along. And some of you that are haven't been here for a while, they're really tricky to open up. You open up the top little section here and you get the wafer that's inside there and take that wafer out. Just leave the juice in there for a minute. I must go to the cross. I must go to Jerusalem. You know, it's interesting that, you know, it says in the Bible that Jesus could have called down legions of angels at any time.
Yep.
But he had to pay the full brunt of our sins on the cross. So join in as we sing this song, and then we'll take communion together. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that before we take communion, before we take of this bread and this juice, he says to examine ourselves. Do an examination of where you're at with the Lord. Is there any sin that we need to confess? Is there anything that we need forgiveness for? He says, we confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive us and to cleanse us. And so he says, before you take this, don't take it unworthily. Check your heart. Make sure you put Jesus number one in your life. And if there's anything that got in the way of that, then he says, ask his forgiveness and be healed. Be set free. Because it says, as often as you partake of this bread and this juice, you're doing this in remembrance of Jesus' supreme, almighty sacrifice. He says, I come to this world. He came to die. His mission was to die. They would sacrifice lambs at Passover. And this was the 50th year Passover, so it was a very special time, very special Sabbath. And they estimate 275,000 lambs were sacrificed every Easter, Passover. 275,000. And Jesus says, I am your Passover lamb. I paid the price once and for all for your sins. That's why John the Baptist said when Jesus, he saw Jesus coming, he says, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Wow. So just close your eyes, and those that are at home, close your eyes. And you know, conviction of God's Spirit. You know, He's in this place. If there's anything that we need to ask God's forgiveness for, ask Him right now to heal you, to cleanse you, to give you that hope that only He can give you tonight. God, pour out Your Spirit upon us. Give us a fresh anointing of Your Spirit, God. Cleanse us. May we be holy vessels that can be set apart and used by You. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. As our heads are bowed, if there's something that you need to ask God's forgiveness, a healing of some type spiritually in your life, just raise your hand and say, "Yeah, God, that's me. I need that tonight." Many people all over the room. Anybody else? God bless you. God bless you in the back. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Lord, set us free. We want to be sold out to You. We do not want to be sold out to Satan. You can't serve two gods. You'll love one and you'll hate the other. We want to be sold out to You tonight, Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit. God, this bread is a reminder to us of Your body that was broken for every person individually here tonight. Broken. He cried over our sins. He wept. And now He says, "I love You. I love You. You're the prodigal son, the prodigal daughter. You have been twice bought. You're coming back to Me, Your Creator. You want to have fellowship with Your Creator. Now you're twice Jesus. You've been bought. You were created and you've been bought by Him on the cross. We ask Your forgiveness of sins. Thank You. You're faithful to cleanse us. Start us on a new path with You tonight.
Blood of the Lamb.
A new, fresh touch of Jesus tonight. Jesus said, "Take and eat. This is My body that was broken for you. Take and eat."
Go ahead and stand.
taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name.
Wasn't rub-a-dub-dub, thanks for the grub, right? It was about his death. The blood of Jesus. Wasn't now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Man, it was a fresh touch of Jesus.
Amen.
From the cross, he said, it is finished.
Woo, hallelujah.
It's been paid for.
Got it done. Hallelujah.
An earthquake came.
He did it.
The veil in the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom.
Set your spirit free, Lord.
Many people were raised from the grave.
Yes, Lord. Raise them.
There was darkness over the land for 3 hours. Truly, this is the Son of God.
Jesus, Son of God. Amen.
He said, this is my blood of the covenant, which is shed on behalf of many at Calvary Chapel La Mesa this night for the forgiveness of sins. He says, I'm not going to drink of the fruit of this vine from now until that day.
Someday
soon when I'll drink it new with you
someday.
In my Father's kingdom. Take and drink. Hallelujah. It's great to see you tonight. Great to see all those watching online. Remember the service tomorrow night. Be in prayer. You know that people maybe that haven't been to church all year would come and be fed the Word of God and Sunday morning at 10 o'clock.
Amen.
You know that God's Word would go forth in power and might.
Blessed be His name.
And speak to people's hearts. And they would ask Jesus into their lives as Lord and Savior. He is what?
Risen!
He is risen. The grave is empty. The grave is empty. Let's sing our closing song.
Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ, my Savior, you rescued me. I love you, Lord. set me free. Christ my Savior, rescue me.
Hallelujah, yes. Hey, Easter weekend, great time to tell others about Jesus. You know, invite somebody, call them on the phone, say, hey, I'll pick you up. Let's go to church tomorrow night. You know, let's go to church Sunday morning. You know, I mean, all of us have friends that maybe aren't Christian, or maybe they backslid. You know, invite them out after church and say, hey, I'll take you out for coffee. I'll take you across the street for Yum Yums. You know? I'll take you to Denny's. Use my AARP card, 20% off. You know? Share the good news. Share the good news. It is good news. It's good news. Eternal life. So it's great to see all of you here. God bless you. Thanks for coming. May God be with you. May God be with you. Give you hope. He's the God of hope. God bless.